So in this video lecture, we'll be starting with a new topic, that is faults. In the previous one, we did folds. We completed the folds. So faults. Now, what are these faults? The definition is the fractures in the rock along which there has been relative movement of blocks past each other are termed as faults. Now, consider this as a hypothetical mass of a rock. And there are these two fractures. Fractures are nothing but cracks. But these fractures will be called as a fault only if there is a movement in the rock. So a fracture becomes a fault only if there is a movement in the rock. And the plane about which that movement happens, that is called as a fault plane. So this is the movement, correct? And these are the fractures. It can also happen that there is a thrust that is coming from the sideways, and because of it, which the middle portion, it rises upwards, as opposed to the previous animation that we saw, that the middle one was sinking down. If we have a side thrust, then the middle rock will rise up. So you can see in this image as well how well defined this fault is. These are all the sedimentary bedding layers that you can see, and you can see that this rock has been displaced downwards a little bit. The layers have shifted downwards, correct? Here also you can see that how this layer has shifted downwards, and how again here also one more faulting has taken place. So let us learn about the fault terminologies. First is fault plane. So what is fault plane? Is the plane along which it is a planar surface of fracture along which the fault takes place. If the fault plane is non-planar, it is called as fault surface. If it is not if it is not plane, then it is called as a surface. Dip and head. Now, dip is the angle of the fault with the horizontal, and head is the angle of the fault with vertical. So if I have to show it here, it will be, this is dip, which is the angle of this fault plane with respect to the horizontal plane, and this is head, which is angle of the fault plane with respect to vertical. This is called as a foot wall. This is called as a hanging wall. Now, how to identify which is foot wall and which is hanging wall? So every fault which happens, it divides the rock into two blocks. Each one is called as a wall. Okay, the block on upper side of the wall is called as hanging wall. I guess this should not be wall. It is the block on the upper side of the fault plane is called as hanging wall, and that on the lower side of the fault plane is called as a foot wall. So if this is the fault plane, the block on the upper side, that is this side is this one, right? This is on the upper side of the fault plane, this is on the lower side of the fault plane. So this would be called as a hanging wall, this would be called as a foot wall. Fault zone. In some cases, the fault is not distinct plane but a zone of small regions with definite thickness and closely spaced parallel fractures with clear displacement. So even in this image, you can see that how there are these zones that have been formed, and this rock and this rock has moved relatively about that zone and not about a single plane. So this is called as a fault zone. Shear zone. In some cases, the faulting takes place leaving a central zone undisturbed. The faulting takes place on either side of this zone. Such a zone is called as a shear zone. So here as well, we have a zone, but that zone is not cracked. Only it has two fault planes which are there. In the previous one, fault zone, even this was cracked, right? So this was a weak portion, and along that the faulting took place. But here we have two distinct fault planes forming, First is this one, and the second is this one. And the blocks are moving relative to each other, relative to that fault plane, basically. Sixth is slip. It is the displacement between two points which were at same location before faulting and have now separated after faulting has taken place. So if these are the two blocks, then after faulting, this point A will move to this point. Earlier it was here, okay, and after faulting it has moved to this. So this would be called as a slip, and this is a strike slip. The displacement in this occurs along the direction of the strike line, hence it is called as a strike slip. Now strike line, we have already learned about dip and strike, right? So if this is a bedding plane like this, if there is a bedding plane here, okay, let us suppose that it is divided like this. So this would be the strike direction, and along that, since this slip is happening, it is called as a strike slip. We will actually learn this in detail in the upcoming slides. If the slip is happening vertically, that is this point A and A dash, again this slip is called as a dip slip, because again I'll just draw that previous thing. If these are your planes like this, bedding planes, then this is the dip, right? This is the strike, and the one that is perpendicular to it is called as dip. So this slip is happening along the dip direction, and that is why it is called as a dip slip. Third one, if they are not moving either horizontally nor they are moving vertically, but they are moving in a oblique manner like this, in a oblique direction, then it is called as a oblique slip. The displacement in this occurs along the oblique direction, hence it is called as oblique slip. Slick inside, these are surfaces of faults that bear clear evidence of frictional rubbing, such as formation of striations or grooves on the fault plane. They are formed only when the fault is relatively new and may weather away with time. So when you can see a strike slip being formed, and what happens is when this slip is forming or when the fault is happening, this plane, along the fault plane, there may be striations or there may be grooves, because two huge rocks are sliding against each other, right? But if this surface is exposed to weathering for a very long time, will those striations remain? No, they will fade away, correct? So they can form a good evidence to understand and study the faulting that has taken place. So if those striations are very very much distinct and very much visible, then it can be said that the faulting that has taken place is somewhat new, okay? Now this is Gaussian fault brazier. During the faulting process, there is rubbing at fault plane between the walls of the fault, and this creates a lot of crushed materials at the interface. This can prove to be an important indicator in studying fault. So when there is a faulting that takes place, because the rocks rub against each other, a lot of small fine particles are generated, and these fine particles fall down. Okay, studying these fine particles, we can understand why and how that thing took place. And these fine particles can be called as a gauge if the material formed is very finely powdered and clay like. This indicated that there was a strong rubbing action due to mutual friction, right? So if this powder that has been formed, it is very fine in nature, there can be two possibilities. First is that obviously the rubbing of this rock and this rock, that is hanging wall and foot wall, was very strong, and that produced a very fine powder. For example, when we put something into the mixer, there are different levels on which we can churn it, right? Levels on which we can mix it. The highest one, it mixes very fine. So on that highest one, your mixer turns very violently and viciously. So we can say that there is a strong grinding action at that point of time. But we can also get this fine particle if the rock itself is weak. So the two cases that I am telling you, two cases. First one is strong action, strong grinding, and second one is weak rock. So it can be either of them or both of them. Either the rock was weak, and that is why even with a weak grinding action it produced a fine particle, or the rock was strong but the grinding was also strong. And this is what we can understand by studying this gouge and fault breccia. The other term is breccia, which is called as, which basically means that if the material formed is not fine but angular and fragmented, this can indicate that either the rock at the interface were very hard or the rubbing action was not very strong. So this can again mean two cases. First one, that weak grinding, right, or strong rock. Now we come to the topic of classification of faults. So on basis of movement, we have this normal fault. So we have hanging wall, which is on top of the fault plane, and we have a foot wall, which is at the bottom of the fault plane. If this is the condition, you can see that a normal fault has taken place, and how this part has moved down and this part has either it has moved up or it has stayed in its place. So the fault in which the hanging wall has apparently, this word apparently is important, apparently moved down with respect to foot wall is classified as normal fault. Why apparently? Because there can be three cases that happen here. Either only the hanging wall moves down, okay, or only hanging wall stays in its position and the foot wall moves up, or the third case would be foot wall moves up and hanging wall moves down, right? So in all the cases we will have hanging wall in an apparent position with foot wall, and it can be seen downwards. In this case, it cannot be clearly said that whether it was hanging wall moved down or foot wall that had moved up, or both walls moved relative to each other. So this is what I was talking about. The fault plane can be inclined to any angle. However, common angles are 45 degrees to nearly vertical. So this fault plane can be at an angle of 45 degree. 45 degree, or it can be nearly vertical as well, right? These faults cause an extension in the earth crust. Now because of these faulting, see what happens. Earlier this hanging wall was like this, intact, right? Earlier this hanging wall was here, but after its movement it has displaced the rock, it has displaced the adjacent rock by this much amount. So it has caused extension in the earth's crust. On basis of movement again, we have a Horst and Graben fault. When two normal faults appear on either side of a central wedge shaped elongated block in such a way that central wedge appears raised high up with respect to the sides. So this is called as a Horst. You can see here in this image how there are three basically rocks which have moved with respect to each other, and the central wedge has moved upwards. So when the central wedge appears to be raised up with respect to the outstanding walls meaning these two walls, this structure is called as a horst. What is graben? Graben is the central wedge which has moved downwards. So you can see how this wedge has moved downwards as comparison to the other two. And the definition also, it remains the same. It is reverse of horst, in which the central wedge has moved down with respect to the outer flank walls. Vertical fault. So you can see that the fault plane here is nearly vertical, and it need not need any explanation. Faults in which the fault plane is vertical or nearly vertical and the resulting movement of blocks is also in vertical direction are called as vertical faults. Reverse fault. In this, what happens? In the normal fault, what used to happen? The hanging wall used to move down with respect to the foot wall. Means apparently with respect to the foot wall. Here the hanging wall will move up apparently with the respect to foot wall. So in such type of fault, the hanging wall appears to have moved up with respect to the foot wall. In reverse faults, the fault plane is generally inclined between horizontal and 45 degrees, although reverse fault with steeply inclined fault planes have also been formed. Reverse faults, as opposite to normal fault, involve shortening of earth's crust. So if this was the ground, okay, ground level, generally this is how we indicate ground level, and earlier this hanging wall was here, okay, so when it moved up this much amount, by this much amount, it caused shortening of the earth's crust. Next is thrust fault. So we have seen this structure in faults, if you remember, and this is called as a recumbent fault. So what happens that because of this highly overturned or recumbent type of folding, weak rocks break due to stresses. And when the weak rocks, and where will the stresses be maximum? The stresses will be maximum at this point, right? On the axial plane itself, the stresses would be very much maximum, and that is the point where the rocks break. And there is a relative movement. If I divide this into its axial plane, then the upper part is generally trying to move this way, and the lower part wants to move this way. Okay, and because of that, because of this overturning, this part will move in relation to the bottom part, and again this is called as faulting. So such type will be called as a thrust fault. It is a type of reverse fault in which the hanging wall has moved relative to the foot wall with the fault angle being less than 45 degrees. This generally occurs in faults which are subjected to further stresses of folding and break in a certain plane. Thrust fault. By the way, the previous type can happen in an overturned folds, right? Overturned folds. We have studied this in the folding part. These thrust faults are of two types. First is overthrust and second is called as underthrust. What is overthrust? In this, the hanging wall moves up in relation to the foot wall, and if hanging wall is actively involved in the faulting process with respect to foot wall, then it is called as overthrust. Second, in the underthrust, if the bottom, that is the foot wall, moves in relation with the hanging wall, again in the downward direction, it should look like the hanging wall is moved up, but here the bottom foot wall has moved down. This is called as underthrust. So the foot wall is actively involved in the faulting process with respect to hanging wall, then it is called as underthrust. Then this is napis. Napis is, this term is used for blocks which have translated for long distances, often ranging to several hundred kilometers. So if this thrust plane is very huge and it is almost like around 100 kilometers, it would be called as a nimbus. The large scale movement may be attributed to major overthrusting or a recumbent folding followed by a thrust fault. So this is it for today's lecture. In the next lecture, we'll be learning more, because the classification of faults on basis of movement has not yet finished. This topic is not finished. So we will continue this topic in the next lecture. Till then, take care. Thank you.